Soul called Everett Samuels, who gave me a Bible and said, "Here, you're going to be a minister." I laughed her to scorn. And she said, "I don't know, I keep losing my keys. I keep losing my keys." Well, this morning the keys were temporarily misplaced, so I used the affirmation, "Nothing is lost in the mind of God." I told it to Everett as well. I said, "Everett, whenever you lose anything, just say, nothing is lost in the mind of God." Can we say that together? Nothing is lost in the mind of God. Well, the next Sunday, I wanted to know if Everett remembered what I had told her. So I said, "Everett, how is the affirmation working?" She said, "Lovely, lovely, reverend." It wasn't a reverend, you know. And I said, "Well, what is it I told you?" She said, "I said, Jesus Christ, I lost the damn key again." "It works like a charm, reverend." Good morning, family. And good morning and welcome to the beautiful Temple of Light, Center for Spiritual Living. And those people who are with us on the World Wide Web, welcome to our hearts and to our beautiful temple. And speaking of practitioners in training, I learned from Dr. Elmer when I was doing my practicum for the practitioner course, a wonderful spiritual game. I call it a game because we used to do this. We would just close our eyes, open the Bible or other spiritual literature, jab our finger in and say, "What do I need to know for my spiritual growth today?" Now, some of you may know the story of how this game got me into trouble and also how it confirmed my call to ministry. We were at, I think it was Braco in the sea, and Dr. Elmer was going to baptize Reverend Dr. Rainbow Johnson, who was visiting with us from Austin in Texas. Now, we don't baptize in this church, so I thought this a very strange thing to be happening. So Rainbow had said, "Elmer, dear, baptize me." So Elmer said, "Rainbow, you mean you've never been baptized?" And she said, "Many, many times, darling, but never in the Caribbean Sea." So I was sent to fetch some kind of receptacle, and I found this perfect half a coconut shell. Rinsed it out in seawater and gave it to Dr. Elmer. We're standing in a big circle, all of the practitioners in training, with Dr. Elmer and Rainbow in the center, and she pours this wonderful libation over Rainbow's head and says this blessing. And then we were told that each of us must say a short spiritual mind treatment or affirmative prayer to bless Rainbow's baptism. And before it came my time to pray, I swear I heard a voice say, "You are going to be a minister and baptize people with the truth." It was so clear that I looked at the person on my right and said, "What you say?" And the person said, "Shh, John." So I looked at the person on my left. I said, "You spoke?" They said, "Shh, John." So it came my time to pray. I was so bewildered. I think I mumbled something in my treatment about Rainbow being baptized with the truth. And I thought it's pure foolishness I had said. But later on, Reverend Emma said, "What a beautiful treatment, baptizing people with the truth." End of story part one. Story part two, that night, I opened the Bible and closed my finger and said, "What do I need to know for my spiritual growth today?" I jabbed my finger. I opened it to Isaiah 6, verse 8. And let me read it for you. I quote, "And I heard the voice of the Lord saying, 'Whom shall I send, and who will go for us?' Then said I, 'Here am I, send me.' The rest, as they say, is history, but for me it is mystery, and perhaps mystory." So fast forward, friends, to last Wednesday, just Wednesday this past week, when Maestro Dexter telephoned to ask, which is his usual habit, bless his heart, "What is my theme for today's encouragement?" And I mumbled something about it being to do with light, and he wanted to choose an appropriate musical item to support my talk, bless him. I knew when he asked me that I wanted to explore the subject of intuition, but it hadn't yet gelled in my mind. I wasn't sure which way I was going to go. So as soon as I hung up the phone from Maestro, I opened my Bible, which was on my bedside table, and I just closed my eyes and said, "What is to be the theme of my encouragement," as I call my messages, "this Sunday?" And as I opened the Bible, my finger hit upon the story in St. John's Gospel, chapter 4, about the interaction of the beautiful Jesus with the woman of Samaria at Jacob's well. And I said, now what on earth does a woman of Samaria at Jacob's well have to do with intuition? You remember the story? It was a hot and dusty day, and Jesus had been traveling a road that was unsafe for a Jew to travel. According to the story, the wayshower came upon Jacob's ancient well and stopped to rest. It was prohibited that he should speak to a strange woman in public, but he did. He asked her to draw water for him, since he had no means of drawing it for himself, and in return, he offered her the water of spiritual awareness, if she would but ask for it. Let me read the short verses 9 to 14 for you. Then saith the woman of Samaria unto him, how is it that thou, being a Jew, askest drink of me, a woman of Samaria? And the author puts a little note, for the Jews have no dealings with the Samaritans. Jesus answered and said unto her, if thou knowest the gift of God and who it is that saith to thee, give me to drink, thou wouldest have asked of him, and he would have given thee living water. Art thou greater than our father Jacob, which gave us the well and drank thereof himself and his children and his cattle? She asked. Jesus answered and said to her, whosoever drinketh of this water shall thirst again. But whosoever drinketh of the water that I shall give him shall never thirst. But the water that I shall give him shall be in him a well of water springing up into everlasting life. End of that scripture. Dr. Matthew Fox, the American priest, theologian, and author, whom I had the pleasure of meeting some years ago at a minister's conference, and who, by the way, was excommunicated from the Dominican order by Cardinal Ratzinger, who later became Pope Benedict. Ratzinger, right. But I think it has been reversed. But Matthew Fox says that the many world religions, this proliferation of religions all over the globe, are like wells dug by people all over the globe who are thirsty for the meaning of life. He made the point that there are innumerable wells, but they are all fed from one stream, one source, which is God. Noting that healthy spirituality is about the purification of our longing. The fact that I got my call to ministry standing waist deep in water was not lost on me. The purification of our longing. So water has a very special significance for me. And I love, at my home I have a little fountain. I like the sound of dripping water to be near me all the time. But what is the meaning of this story, friends? And what has it got to do with intuition? Who was this woman whom Jesus met at the well? And what does the meeting of these two people symbolize for us? As I've shared with you from this platform several times, Bible stories are really our stories. They're stories about us because they reflect back to us information about our own journey through life. Now, the woman in any biblical story is symbolic of the feminine within each of us. I want you just to remember that. Whenever you read about a woman in the Bible, it is symbolic of the feminine aspect of your nature. So these stories tell us about meaningful interaction between the masculine and feminine aspects of ourselves. The feminine aspect of being signifies intuitive perception and natural love. So the story of the woman at the well is showing us that the intuition and natural love within each of us draw life to the surface. They bring forth life. Deep within each one of us is that wellspring of life that can be drawn into consciousness to satisfy our thirst for the life more abundant. And aren't we about wanting to experience that life more abundant? And so the story is advising that we allow our intuition and natural love, the feminine aspect of our natures, to draw vitality and strength from the well of life, which is the deep mystical place within each one of us. There is this well, I call it the well of self, this deep place from which you can draw all the sustenance, all the love, all the joy, all the wisdom, all the good that you could ever hope to imagine and that you could ever embody. Because there is that woman within each of us that stands beside the well of our lives, the well of ourselves. The well of life, my friends, is very deep, for it is fed by the one source of being, God, and our feminine side has the means to bring forth the water from it. Water represents the universal solvent. It is the solution of all life in potential. So I want you, whenever you are using water in any way, washing the dishes, or washing the car, or bathing, or just washing your hands before you eat, whenever you are dealing with water, to remember that you are dealing with this deep, deep, mystical thing, which is the solution of all life, all of your life, all of your affairs in potential. Like Jesus, then, we must approach the woman, the feminine within us, and ask for the water. And we do this by becoming more aware of and in touch with our intuitive knowing about life. Just this morning in the prayer room, Dr. Freddy shared with me, he said, "You must make me know your business well, see it here now." He shared that he went to a meeting and he had a decision to make and he hadn't decided what he was going to do. And it came to him full-orbed in the middle of the meeting and he just acted on that. That is the feminine intuition in him that he had learned to trust and to follow, to act on. He didn't stop, I think, and say, "Well, I wonder if I should do this." He just did it. If you know Dr. Freddy, that's how he is, though. He just, "Here you go. I have made the decision." And so that deep knowing, that deep understanding, which comes to us without the benefit of logic or reasoning or asking the advice of 300,000 people, it, you know, when you know it, you just know and you know that you know. That's the intuitive factor, the feminine aspect of your nature. And in the past, that feminine faculty, call it that, was erroneously regarded as illogical, weak, and undependable, and in some cultures, even dangerous. At one time, people used to speak disparagingly of feminine intuition. But we know today that learning to listen to our intuitive faculty, which is really our inner tuition, inside tuition, that learning to trust it can change our mode of living from a life that is lived in crisis and fear to a life lived with direction and purpose. And so this morning I wanted to share 5 steps for living from your feminine intuitive self. Are you? Would that be useful information for you? 2 people said yes. Well, I'm going to give the 2 of you. The first step is found in Matthew chapter 6, verse 6, and is given by the master teacher himself. It is this: "Enter into thy closet." Enter into thy closet. Not the untidy one you have that you've been promising to clean out for the longest while, and I'll explain what entering into the closet means. The second step is to pray honestly with your heart. The third step, listen with detached expectation. 4th, let go and trust. That's a big, big frog. Oh, I'll repeat it for you, you know that. And 5, follow your guidance. So let me run it past my diligent students again. I know those who write it down and do this on their telephone. Enter into your closet, 1. 2, pray honestly with your heart. Number three, listen with detached expectation. You know, you stopped me at number four because it's the hardest one. Let go and trust. And number five, follow your guidance. Act on your guidance. The first step, enter into thy closet, has to do with the architecture of Jewish homes in the time of Jesus. In the center of every home was a closet which had no windows and corresponded architecturally with the Holy of Holies or inner chamber in the Temple of Jerusalem. So right in the center of every home was this closet, which was symbolic of the Holy of Holies. And when you enter into this sacred room, it was used as a retreat for prayer and meditation, but it really doesn't matter where you choose to pray today, and most of us aren't able to enter into our closets because they are already overflowing with stuff we'll never wear again. But it doesn't matter where you pray as long as you find a place of quietude in which to be still and know that I am, comma, God. You know, it's so important to find that place of stillness. Having scattered the ashes of my dear friend Andrew last Wednesday, I've been dealing with my own grief by working in my garden. That's my closet. And I have been reminded how quickly a natural setting soothes me and triggers new perceptions and new understanding within me. And so I want to invite you to try that for yourself. Just walk in nature. Visit us here at the temple and sit in the meditation garden for a short while. I also find that deep breathing and yoga and quiet music put me in that closet, that still place in which all of the vicissitudes and the hubbub and the hassle of life is external to me, and I can just be very quiet within myself. Enter into your closet, there to be still. The second step, heartfelt prayer, is simple and natural. Well, as students of the science of mind, we know that we need never beg or beseech or cajole God for our good. Instead, we claim what we are ready and willing to receive. And Jesus gave us the perfect prototype prayer, and he said, give us this day our daily bread. He didn't say, oh dear, wonderful Lord up in the sky sitting on a cloud, perhaps just one crumb may fall from your mighty table onto the plate of one so unworthy and worthless as I. No, it was a demand on the universe. Give us this day what we require to live the life more abundant that you promised us. So declare in prayer every day that abundant life, abundant prosperity, abundant love, abundant health, abundant good are yours. And if you don't know how to do a spiritual mind treatment, join a class and learn how to use this powerful tool known as affirmative prayer. We have two dynamite classes beginning next Thursday, by the way, as Dr. Freddy shared. On Thursday mornings at 10:30, we have life patterns based on the four agreements by Ruth. And in the evenings at 7, we have From Whence We Came, an in-depth exploration of how the teachings of the early New Thought luminaries can be applied to our 21st century spirituality. A lot of times we read all the New Thought masters and we think, well, that's very good, but it doesn't apply to my life. But it does if you know how to apply it. Just as when you read the Bible in the consciousness that it's not just some myth, it is a story of your own journey, that you can extrapolate from it what you need to live triumphantly as a son or daughter of the royal household of God. Now, after praying, your third step, it's often overlooked. After praying, especially when you're asking for guidance, sit in silence for a while and just listen. Listen. You may not hear anything, or you may get a hunch, but getting a hunch isn't necessary. The purpose of sitting in silence is to become more receptive to the intuitive guidance that we are receiving at a very deep level of our being. You do not have to be aware of the guidance. It will filter into your awareness in the coming days or weeks. For intuition often reveals itself as knowledge that is so subtle you won't be able to determine when it came or where it came from. You will just know and know that you know that this is the right move to make. So be still after you pray and claiming your good and just listen for a while in silence. The fourth step is to let go and trust. And this is the big frog, isn't it? We pray and we say, this is what we want. And if you'll just do it this way, God, I'll be very happy. You know, Reverend Tommy used to say, it said, speak, Lord, thy servant heareth. But we say, hear, Lord, thy servant speaketh. The fifth step is to act upon your guidance. And this is where the masculine aspect of your being, the aspect that is action-oriented, comes into play. So the masculine aspect of our natures works in union with the feminine knowing, whose real function is to empower and illumine the intellect as the masculine galvanizes us into action. But you see, we have to be still first. How many of us, particularly we guys, we jump up and we're off and running, you know, at a solution before waiting to think and to be still? I have a girlfriend who complains because as soon as she starts telling me something, I say, well, what we need to do is, and she said, I never asked you what we need to do. I want you just to listen because I want to bitch. So just listen. So, you know, I'm saying, okay, then if that's what you want me to do, I'll listen. And when you're finished the bitching, you can also do explaining. And of course, that's very often what people want to do. They just want to vent. And having vented, then they can then look at it from a more detached and rational point of view. And then you can begin to think about where we want to go and how we want to go about it. So the male in us wants to do, and the feminine wants us to be still and to know. So you see, friends, the masculine and feminine within us only seem like strangers. When you become conscious of and begin to honor the two aspects of yourself, they can meet and ask life of each other. As the woman at the well did with the master teacher. They meet and share the truth that each knows about the other. And those two aspects of ourselves know the truth about their individual functions and how they work in a complementary way with each other. In our world today, we are beginning to wake up to who we are as men and women. Our masculine and feminine are not separated by male and female bodies. Our masculine and feminine exist as two vital aspects of our being that create our wholeness and indeed our holiness. And so here's a new slant on Genesis 1, verse 27, which tells us, male and female created he them. Male and female created he them, not two separate, one male, one female, because we are both. Both faculties exist within each one of us. So if something doesn't seem to be going right in your life, you can better determine the problem if you understand these aspects of your being and how they can help you. Listen within for the promptings of your intuition and watch yourself this week to see if your actions are based upon love before you rush to action. Be mindful whether your intuition is saying one thing while your intellect is stubbornly going in another direction. Ask yourself whether the man and woman within you have met through your awareness of them and have spoken at the well of your life. And this brings me to your assignment. Every time you take a drink of water this week, and you should be drinking lots of water, as you know, sip it mindfully and affirm silently, I drink deeply from the well of life. Can we say that? I drink deeply from the well of life. It is the well of self. It is the well of self. Together? The well. fed by God, my never-failing source.
Fed by God.
So I drink deeply from the well of life. It is the well of self fed by God, my never-failing source. It is the well of self fed by God, my never-failing source. Let the woman at your well give you to drink this week. Trust your intuition and go after that dream that you have long held. And as you do, trust your masculine side to ensure that you take well, pun intended, well thought out, logical steps towards the attainment of your desires. The masculine and feminine within you are not in competition. They can and will work together to create beautiful experiences and outcomes in your life. Let's go back to Jacob's well again. Jesus and the woman were in dangerous territory. Jesus, because he was a Jew in Samaritan territory, and the woman, because she was alone and unprotected. As each shared the waters of life, both natural and spiritual, there was no competition between them. There was no fear of loss. There was only the giving and mutual benefit between these two aspects. In today's world, we appear to be walking a rocky road in human culture. All over the world, we see evidence that if we are to create a world that truly works for everyone, we have to cross the ancient boundary lines of old prejudices and old paradigms. In the USA, we have seen the first ever black man as president, and now there is the possibility that there will be the first ever woman president. Now more than ever, we need to allow the masculine and feminine aspects of our nature to unite as we discover and celebrate our eternal oneness as spiritual beings having a human experience. Dr. Ernest Holmes, who gave us this great teaching, writes in the Science of Mind textbook the following, and I quote, "Spirituality springs from within, coming from that never-failing source of life which quenches every thirst, whose source is eternity, the wellspring of self-existence," unquote. What I know for each of you is that as you drink deeply from the well of self, radiant health, harmonious relationships, perpetual prosperity, and true wisdom are the divine outpourings which fill your cups of acceptance to the brim and overflow into your world so that you will never thirst again. Namaste.